I think everybody felt exactly the same way, sort of excited to be asked, because it's a really big deal, but also really nervous about how it might rebound on us, all mixed into a cocktail, really.
Everyone's passionate about football, so if the song isn't right, they're going to really pan you. So it was kind of a bit of a scary moment.
I got an email a few weeks ago from our manager saying the FA have asked you if you want to do the World Cup song. Any thoughts? My initial thoughts were, oh my God, couldn't possibly. What if we look like idiots? But it's a massive honour. Oh, go on then.
I think EMI put us forward to the FA, and the FA thought, oh, embrace the right anthemic kind of sing-along tunes. They might be good for the job. And basically Tony Perrin, our manager, just went in with a demo of the song, and apparently one of them in the office there said immediately, the hairs are going up on the back of my neck, this is fantastic.
2 days after it's announced, the day after it's announced, we're in every single, you know, major paper, you know, like two-page spreads and things, and you suddenly think, God, this is actually, you know, a massive deal, and people are really going to go overboard on it.
There's always something about when a band play a song for the first time and they've just figured, you know, you have like, you do it and you blast through it and then everybody writes down little changes and like, you know, let's tighten that bit up and then press record and play, and that's usually where you'll get the magic, because it's a mixture of excitement, pent-up tension and just the joy, you know, five people in a room and the sound coming out is just, if it's right, it's much bigger than you would expect five people to be able to make.
All my friends are saying, oh my God, what are you going to write about? How are you going to do it? Because I've never written a song about football before. And for me, the most important thing was that the song came from a really true place, you know. So I was trying to sort of remember back to the time when England were doing well in Euro 96 and then in the last World Cup, they did quite well. And just that sort of feeling that you get, that just really weird, freaky optimism that comes from out of nowhere, you know. And to me, that's like a really serious business. And so that's why we went into this really wholeheartedly, because optimism is like such an important thing these days, I think.
Let's go in there, a bit less pedal, bit more in the groove of the drums.
Can you hear that? Oh. It helps if you put the right headphones on. Hello? Sorry, I had the wrong headphones on.
The guitar part's kind of what made the song sound like us, really. Because up until then it was just like four chords going round. And I kind of got this like weird sound of like a combination of pedals that I still can't figure out how I did it.
You know, towards the end of it, bring the echo in. Maybe even start a little bit of wah filtering or something.
Wah filtering.
Hendrix.
That's a trick.
Yeah.
Okay. The five of us are writing now, and it just feels so natural and so instinctive and easy. It's very, very easy. It's never been easy. It's always been, you know, monumentally hard. I've likened it before, but it really does feel like I've been kicking a medicine ball my whole life, only for somebody to just hand me a football and a wide open goal. And that's kind of doubly appropriate now, I suppose. Kind of ironic that I was saying all that back then.
You know, it should be a great song first, which then goes on to be, you know, a great football song. You know, like You'll Never Walk Alone, you know, it wasn't written as a football song.
And you can't really compare this song to Three Lions or World in Motion, because those songs weren't immediately taken into people's hearts when they were written. They became classics because the England teams did really well in those years. They become classics by association because of their cultural importance, you know. I mean, I'm not saying that they're not good songs, they are good songs. But I think to measure this song against those songs isn't fair until after the World Cup's finished.
And the choir in was really a choice of youth, our producer, who quite likes his orchestras and choirs, to say the least.
It was like one song that we were concentrating on this time instead of a whole album, and so we just threw everything at it. And we kind of, for every sort of five things we threw at it, one stuck. I think if we'd had all the faders turned up for everything that we recorded on it, it'd just be like a white noise, because there wasn't anything we didn't try.
Really nice. As well as the choir part.
Doing sort of like a gentle, maybe just the girl sort of side of it. Sounds good, man. Sounds really good, Basil. Happy in here, we'll record one.
And it does have that kind of anthemic vibe that I think a football song should have. I suppose time will tell if, you know, if they're going to sing it on the terraces, Three Lions style.
But then when we'd got the gospel singers in, it kind of sounded quite sweet and a little bit professional somehow. So we've had this thing since the first album where we get all our, you know, girlfriends and mates into down at the studio, and I'll stand around a microphone and Danny kind of conducts us. And it kind of added a more sort of terracy vibe to it and sort of made it sound more sing-along. It's kind of a trick that we learned quite early on, really, on the early demos about 10 years ago.
It doesn't really matter if you sing out of tune. The whole point about getting the crowd to sing is that you will all sort of sing slightly out of tune and stuff. And what we do is we record you, and then we record you again, and then we double that and double that and double that, so that it sounds like there's like 50, 60 people. So it doesn't matter if you feel like you sound... out of tune, or you feel like you sound odd, that's probably a good thing because it makes the crowd sound bigger.
Okay. With the world at your feet, there's no height you can reach. This could be the one. It's calling.
was in London on my own in the hotel, and there were a lot of bands staying in the same hotel, and they'd all just found out that we'd got the World Cup song, and they're all saying, what's it about, what are the lyrics like? Everybody in the country wanted to know what the song was like. All of them coming up to me and shaking my hand and wishing me all the best, but all of them kind of in their eyes going, I won't be in your shoes, because it could all go really badly wrong. And so then I had to sing it the next day, and I think I actually sang better that day than I've ever sung in the studio before or since in my life. I don't know why.
And that we'd got like a day at Olympic to finish off the song, and that was like guitar overdubs, redo some keyboards, Danny had to sing it, to comp it and all that kind of thing. So it was one pass on strings on a keyboard, and by the time I'd finished doing the keyboard pass, Youth had got on the phone to Will Malone and said, right, we're going to send a tape over to you now, and we need to record the strings tomorrow, can you book the London Session Orchestra? So I didn't get the gig of actually arranging it, unfortunately.
So he rang up Will Malone, and he kind of said, how long have I got? And he says, well, you know, what are you doing this afternoon, sort of thing. And Will went and scored out all the strings and got the string players in sort of the next day.
Mighty, majestic, and much more beautiful than you would believe them to be by just hearing them blended in with all the other instruments. It's when you actually listen to Will's strings on their own that they have this immense beauty.
The music goes with the World Cup and it's going to be stuck in your mind forever. And if England do well, then we're associated with a team that does well, like World in Motion's associated with like Italia 90, where we did really well. So we've got to have a good World Cup, really. But then again, I'm happy just to be part of it.
So this morning I find myself on my way to Radio 1, and we're going to stop at a newsagent on our way there. There's one just down here. I'm going to go in and get all the papers because apparently I'm in a mall. Wow, it's big right up in the mirror. It's the rousing anthem England fans hope will roar their heroes to World Cup glory this summer.
After the football thing was announced, it seemed like everybody knew we were, and you know, you'd be walking around Asda and you can see that people are like, oh, is that so-and-so from Embrace? So
the last week has been crazy. We've never experienced anything like this in Embrace world. Me and Danny were on the front of the Mirror, we were in the Sun, in the Star, the Times, and all these, you know, all the tabloids and the broadsheets, and normally we're sort of stuck in the music press, really.
I think the first play on Chris Moyles, because everybody wanted to hear it. You know, I'd spoken to people and everybody was tuning in specifically just to find out what the song was like. I think people were intrigued.
Hi there. You all right? I'm good, man.
I'm good.
Hiya. You all right?
How are you feeling, Danny?
Feeling really good. A bit hungover, but yeah, feeling really good.
You must be a bit nervous because this isn't your normal publicity surrounding a single launch, is it?
It's surreal. It's totally surreal. Yeah, and I'm very nervous, yeah.
Morning, Danny! How are you?
I'm good, man. How are you?
Right there.
How are you?
It had its first ever play in our local pub.
At Last Orders, wasn't it?
Yeah.
It was just before 11 o'clock. They were just ringing the bell and we stuck it on the CD player.
Look at that.
Proper finished copy.
Embrace, world at your feet. Look at that.
Proper finished promo copy.
Danny, there's no CD in it.
Yes, there is.
I'm joking, obviously. Look at that. Isn't it exciting? Right, ladies and gentlemen, here it is. It's the first play ever. This is Embrace and the England song for the World Cup 2006. This is World at Your Feet.
The BBC and all the TVs were filming ghetto blasters around the country in various different pubs as Chris Miles played the first exclusive play on Radio 1 of the song.
For those that halfway through heard something that made no sense, the story is as follows.
This newsreader must have been nervous or something because she played it from when it started. And she walked out halfway through the second verse before it even kicked into one of the two choruses that there are in the song, where it all kind of kicks off.
It's a winner!
What do you think, Reese? You're the co-host of the local breakfast show. Do you think it's going to get people going?
It's a bit slower than I thought it was going to be honest with you.
Just as it was getting going, they were passing their opinions, and Chris Miles was really furious about that. He's going, why don't they just listen to it? Listen to this. How can you say that's slow? Listen to it. And he was just like, I'm going to do something. And Comedy David's sidekick was like, don't, Chris. It's the first national play of this song. You can't.
It's not too slow. It's perfect. Shut up and enjoy it.
It's perfect, but I'm sure...
I'm going to say something and everybody's going, don't say that. Because I'm going, it's the first play I'm watching on the radio, I'm not going to say something, I don't care. And he just puts me in, like, it's not bloody slow.
And the third person, I thought it was going to be a bit faster, which is why I went, it's not too slow, it's fine.
So we can then see them on the telly, then laughing at us saying it's fine, it's not too slow.
And so, like, sort of the relief that actually, you know, people thought we'd made a good decision because we had a good song. Yeah, that was a pretty monumental day. I'm getting recognised a lot more now, and it's kind of a bit weird.
Sorry, I can text and walk all at the same time. I sound really happy. So you need to draft the...
You know, it's all been a bit like that for the last few weeks. People are just hanging around. When we did Match of the Day 2, normally there's about 3 or 4 people in the studio. That day there were about 50 people all having a look to see what was going on.
I think when we did it, there seemed to be loads of people watching, because it was the first time a lot of people had heard the song.
Everybody was massively positive about, you know, people coming up to us and patting us on the back and saying, oh, it's a great song and stuff. It couldn't have gone better, you know.
Before I play it, I can't believe, here am I, a proud Scotsman, sitting playing the England World Cup. I mean, I know...
I got you a little present
in
relation
really?
To that, yeah, because I heard about that, so that you might want this as well.
There you go.
White shirt. Oh,
God,
no,
listen,
I'll never.
Oh, please.
The world
is coming.
It's
coming. So, yeah, the PFA Awards were the ones that I was most nervous for.
We pulled up outside it and there was a proper red carpet. And we had the wives and girlfriends with us and they were really panicking about it. You know, they didn't want to be, you know, papped and end up in Heat magazine.
Like stars in the sky.
It is going to bring us to a lot wider audience. You know, we've always had a very loyal fan base that followed us through the last 10 years, but this is just completely widening it to a massive degree. I think it's just going to cross over to everyone.
It can be, yes, it can be done.
Please welcome Embrace. It is the official FA anthem, World at Your Feet.
The world, it's calling, it's calling you now. You know it's gonna be your time, cause the world is at your feet. Yeah, the world is yours, with the world.
continues to be as well received as it has been so far, it could do an amazing amount of good for Embrace, really. You know, it could bring whole new legions of fans to come on board. So I feel really, really positive about it. So.
We'll be stuck in a studio in London somewhere in the freezing cold, and they'll superimpose us going around the Eiffel Tower and across Germany, across mountains.
Might be Amarillo video.
Yeah.
But there have been various scripts, one of which was this starting off kicking this little football and it gradually growing to the size of a house and ending up like going across, rolling across the channel to Germany and then popping into the stadium at the other side, which I think is really good. But you'll probably find by this time, by the time you see this, the video will be out, so it'll be nothing like that. There you go.
Every video we do seems to be windy or cold or have us hung on wires that dig right in. And they always seem to be torturing somewhere. Danny was buried up to his neck in sand. That was my idea, actually. And there's one about us all in a van. I haven't seen actual treatment on that. It's kind of, it's been on mood boards. It's people all going to Germany in vans.
No idea.
No idea. No idea. We turned up this morning. We sat on a beach. We've been in a transit van. And we still have no idea what the video is. I'm sure.
We're in a van.
We're in a van, yeah, we're in a van. Somewhere.
In a van. Driving to Germany.
Are we? What, on the beach?
I assume so.
Okay. Yeah, we're on our way to the World Cup van.
Okay, playback. No idea. Just go away.
I've got some. Oh, it's
Germany.
Footy cards. How long do they punch out? And they must be, you must be able to play some game.
I want one. Thank you.
Footy cards is quite interesting.
I've got Rooney!
Oh! Rooney!
He's going to be fit.
He's
going to be fit.
He is.
The world is at your
feet. Yeah, the world is here. With the world at your feet. We're going to Trafalgar Square next week to film the finale of the video.
That.
But we don't, still don't really know what's going on.
Best day, honestly. I can honestly say I get more nervous watching England play than I do going on stage for Embrace. I can't bear it. You know, I have to have at least 4 or 5 cans of lager just to numb myself to the...
With regards to whether we're going to get to go to the World Cup or not, we're free. We've left our days free. And if we get through to the semi or the final, we've left all of those days free. And there's no way I'm booking anything else on any of those days. With the world at your feet, there's no height you can reach. This could be the world. It's calling you now. You know it's gonna be our time. Cause the world is at your feet. Yeah, the world is at your feet.
Carry on.
Good. But you have to take, possibly you have to take him out. That's not a good shot. What? Oh, that's always come out of crap.
not so much. Until the end, when it's got it written through it.
Yeah.
It's the only time I'm going to do this.
Can I get on there?
No, you can beat me on. Alright.
Give him an inch, you text him, mate.
Can I get on there?
That's only your name.
It's only a few people I've knelt in front of to be beaten.
Yeah?
But I love this song. Can
cool,
I tell
man.
You that?
Cool.
Bigger and better and shinier and all singing and dancing, you know, but this is roughly what it's going to sound like. And they just loved it. They said, oh wow, it's amazing, it's everything we want, you know, the hairs on my back and my neck are standing up. And they've got hairy necks, the FA. But yeah, so it was kind of cast in stone pretty early on, really.
If you got Kat in, just get a final shot of Tetley. He's a good lad.